Hi, welcome. And let me be your guide on this tour of React, where I'm going to show you why I'm hooked on React, especially the future of React. And I hope by the end you're going to be hooked on React as well. So who am I? Maurice de Beijer, also known as the problem solver. I'm a Microsoft MVP, also freelance developer, instructor. I teach a lot of React, but I develop a lot with it as well. So I also have a React newsletter. So if you're interested in React, go to this URL at the bottom, and there you can subscribe, and you'll get a new newsletter every Wednesday. So before I tell you about the future and why I'm hooked on React, let's take a step back, because every good journey starts with some context, some history. And we're going to take a look at the history of React components. And way back when React first shipped, we had this API, react.create class. You'd pass in an object with a render function like this, and probably some more functions, depending on your component. And life was good, and we were happy. We could use mixins, and we would have auto binding. But it was kind of like, well, it's the React very specific way. And then after some time, the React team started shipping components. So we could create a class greeter here, extends components. So we'd use normal ECMAScript 2015 style classes, and they would be compiled down to older code, ECMAScript 5 for older browsers. But that was really nice. But we did lose something along the way. No more mixins. Auto binding, no, that was gone. But it wasn't a huge problem. Just took a bit and we got used to it and everything was great. And components were really nice. You could add state to them, like over here I've got a loaded state. And you could add lifecycle functions to them. In this case, we've got the component did mount. You could know about components being updated and unmounted. And most of that was pretty easy to use. But still, it's like, lots of components didn't need all that much or might be a bit too hard. So at some point in time, we kind of realized from Houston, we've got a problem. Not everything is as simple as it could be. And one problem is this. And what's this? Well, literally the this keyword in ECMAScript. I've got this little counter here. And we're going to render the current value of the counter and a little button. And if you click on the button, it's going to increment the counter. Or is it? Actually, if you run this, you'll get this error. Cannot read property set state of undefined. Why not? It's this.setState. It's part of the component. Yeah, well, it is. But in JavaScript, the this keyword is actually determined by the way you call into a function, not how it's defined. And this click handler is passed to the button on click event handler, so it's called outside of the context of this component, so this doesn't actually point to the component, but is undefined. So fixing that's pretty simple. I just changed the onClick to be a property with a fat arrow function, and life is good. But it's kind of like, well, with the lifecycle functions, the render, etc., I just define a function. With some custom functions, I just define a function. With some other, I have to use a fat arrow function. It's not hard, but it's kind of like, why sometimes fat arrow, sometimes not? And there is another problem. Like, some responsibilities are split up into different places. I've got some state in this component, little clock component. And basically, I want to update it the time displayed every second. So I've got some states, and in a render, I use that state. And in the component did mount, we start an interval, and that starts updating the state every second. But we want to stop that interval if the component unmounts. So we need to save that handle somewhere. And in the component will unmount, we clear the interval. So it's kind of like I've got states used in three places. I've got a handle for clearing that interval used in a couple of places. So it's not hard again, but the logic is kind of spread out. And then we got functional components. They were really simple. Basically, any time you had a component which just had a, or at least a class-based component, which just had a render function, React team says, oh, okay, now you can just use a functional component. pretty nice, simple, no more this keyword because it's just a function. There is no object there as such. You get the props as a parameter, really easy to use. And originally they were called stateless functional components because there is no state. If you created one of these and you decided, oh, I need to add some state, well, your first step was refactor it into a class-based component. Again, not hard, but it's just one of those other paper cuts, no death by a thousand paper cuts, you had to go through. You wanted to add a lifecycle function? The same kind of thing. Wasn't there, so you had to convert it into a class first before you could. And then there is the problem of if your only tool is a hammer, every problem is a nail. And that turns up a lot in React. I've got a little component stack here. This is actually from a public, very popular website, but it's not uncommon. Lots of my own applications are going to look exactly the same. Now, the screen is pretty big, but it's not really readable, so I zoomed in a bit on a specific part. And if you look at this, it's some kind of container rendering a get tracking info from context, renders a create tracking component, rendering a billboard. And a bit lower down, it's a log presentation manually, wrapping get tracking info from context again, wrapping window visibility, wrapping in viewport, wrapping connect to app. How many wrappers can you add in a dozen components? And this is kind of like, well, if you want to add something to your component stack, you basically have to add it by using a component, because that's the one building block we have. Render props, another one of these things. Great principle, but hard to use. Got another clock example here. Basically using two props from a context. So the context introduced in React 16.3. And count the number of brackets on here. Like round brackets, curly brackets, there are brackets all over the place. You want to add something to this? How hard is it to get the syntax right the first time? I usually just move stuff around until my formatter says, okay, it formats now, so it's probably right. But suppose I could tell you we could start using functional components and everything would just work. It's not a stateless functional component anymore. It can have state. It can have lifecycle functions. It can have all sorts of things. So they become much more capable. And as a side effect, lots of the complexity we see with normal components can be abstracted away into regular functions. Not functional components, functions. And that's a React hook, or React hooks, because there are many of them. Now, right now, it's still a proposal. So all the stuff I'm going to show you now, you cannot use in a production app yet. Like the current version of React 16.63, I believe it is right now, does not have this yet. 16.7 will. There is currently an alpha version of 16.7 available if you want to play around with it. And if you look at it, keep an open mind. Because React kind of shifts the paradigm around a bit. Just like this calculator. Who knows this calculator? A few. So it's the HP41CX. I actually had one of these as a student. But when I first learned about it, it's kind of what a wacky calculator is this. I had an old Casio before that. And if I wanted to add 1 plus 2, I did 1 plus 2 equals. It's like, I need a calculator for that, sorry. With this thing, it was 1, enter, 2, plus. It's like everything is shifted around. The order just changed. It's actually called reverse Polish notation, what they use. And it turned out if you're just adding 1 plus 2, there isn't much benefit. But if you're getting into more complex stuff, it actually is a lot simpler on this calculator. In fact, this one actually went to space because it was so good. They used it in the space station and what was it? Well, the space plane, the name escapes me. And the same was true for React. Like way back when I started in web development, we kind of tended to write HTML files, and we would be a little sloppy. We put a script tag in there, and we would put our JavaScript in there. And then they said, no, that's bad. Split your responsibilities. JavaScript goes into a file with an extension .js. Markup goes into an extension .html. Inside your markup, you write a script tag, which has a source pointing to the JavaScript. You do not combine them. Okay, we did. And then years later, React comes around and says, well, here we've got a JavaScript file, and now we take our markup and put it in the JavaScript file. It's like, what? We can't put our JavaScript in the markup, but we can put the markup in the JavaScript? How can that be right? It turned out we didn't put markup in the JavaScript. It's JSX. It gets compiled. It's not markup and a template which is evaluated. So you need to keep an open mind. So let's take a look at some hooks. Some will get out of the box. And the first is use state. Now I've got another functional component here. It's just a function. There's no class. There's no this keyword. And on line one, I'm importing use state from React. So at the very top of my component, on line four, I'm calling use state with the value one. I'm basically saying, okay, save me some state for this component, initialize it with the value one, and then I get back two things. I actually get an array back, but I use the array destructuring syntax to give me the current value, the count, and the second, a set count, a function, if I want to change the count, kind of like set state in a component-based or a class-based component. So I can render that, and in the click handler of the button, I call that set count to actually increment the count. I do that, component is re-rendered. Second time it's re-rendered, use state is called again. The one is passed in, but it's actually ignored because it's not the first time it's rendered. It gives me the count of two and a setter to change it if I want to change it again. Now this is a functional component. I'm calling a function, yet it's able to maintain state over calls. It kind of sounds like magic, right? Turns out it's not that magical. If you open up the Chrome debugger tools and you go to the React developer tools and you select that component, it actually looks like this. Now I checked with the React team, and did you update the React dev tools to work with the use state hook? No, we didn't. It just coincidentally shows up. We actually want to change it so it shows up nicer, but it actually shows you that the state is used in almost the same way as a normal component, a class-based component. It just sticks to the back of a React component, even if it's a functional component, and it's maintained along the lifecycle of that component. Another hook, use effect. What's use effect for? It's for doing side effects on components. So use effect takes a first argument, which is a function. And that function is basically your component did mount, and to some extent component did update. And that could possibly return a function, like I do here, which is your component will unmount. But if it's called multiple times, it's actually going to clean up between there. So it's a little more than component will unmount. How often is this going to be called? Well, that's determined by that second parameter on line 14, the interval. An array specifying values. If these values change, you need to rerun that effect. Basically, in the effect, I set up set interval again, but now instead of having to save that handle somewhere on an object, I can just use a local variable because it's just a closure. Inside of that hook, I can use that same state hook again, so I can update the state every second and my component re-renders. So, kind of like a class-based component, but now it's kind of more localized. And it gets better. We can create context. So basically, I've got a context here, which is like the React 16.3 API, and got a time context, which presumably is updated. This was the old code we had. like I'm using two contexts here, a time context and a theming context. So it's kind of like lots of nested brackets and stuff, and hard to read and hard to write. How about this? Who thinks this is worse? No one. So much simpler. I just import use context from React. I use the use context hook to retrieve the current value from a context. So I have the current time and I have the current theme, and I just use them. It sets up a subscription behind the scenes for those. So anytime the context value is updated, this component will automatically re-render. Sweet. Much, much easier. Much easier to write, much easier to read. So there are actually quite a few hooks out of the box. I just showed the three basic hooks. So for state management, we've got useState, and there is a more advanced version of that which uses reducers. Kind of like Redux Lite without all the stuff, but it uses a reducer just like Redux does. So we've got effects, and maybe I went overboard with effects on this slide a bit. But we've got useEffect, which is kind of your component did mount, component will unmount. But there are two specialized versions which kind of work the same way, but they fire somewhat earlier or later, depending on what you need. Usually useEffect is good. You have useContext, just saw that. There are useCallbacks and useMemo for basically calling functions. Especially useMemo uses memoization. So if you call a function with the same parameters multiple times, it's not going to bother to recompute the value, it's just going to return it much faster. There is useRef, which is really great for using refs, like if you need to get a reference to a DOM object, but it turns out it's a lot more flexible. It's kind of your generic state back if you want to store some state along with a functional component, but you don't want to put it in real state because changing it doesn't actually need to re-render the component. You use a ref for that. And you can create custom hooks. You can create your own hooks. Put whatever, well, almost whatever code you want in your own hooks. So take that clock example I just had, the functional clock with the set effect and the use effect and the use state in there. I can extract pretty much all of that into a different hook. I call it use time. Because what did the component really need? It only needed the current time, and whenever it was updated, it would re-render. Well, I can extract all of that, put it into a different hook, and reuse it as is. So what does the component look like? Easy peasy. Just as simple, okay, give me the current time from the use time hook, update it so often, depending on the interval, and I'll re-render whenever that changes. Your hooks might return more, maybe, just depends on what you want to do in the hook. Here's a more complex one. Not really readable, blown, not that big, but it's kind of a fetch one which uses an abort controller. So if you load a component, you do an AJAX request, but the component is unloaded, it will actually abort a request. Or you change the URL, it will abort an ongoing request. So really nice. It actually uses this for the actual request using fetch. So if you want to create your own hooks, there are a few rules you have to follow. First of all, hooks can only be used in functional components. You cannot use them in class-based components. Or you can use them in other hooks. Now first I thought, well, the fact that I can't use them in class-based components is kind of painful. I'm going to write reusable logic in hooks. I can't use that in a class-based component. But then I thought about it and, well, if I'm going to extract some code which I've got in a class into a hook, I'm probably going to change that class anyway into a functional component. So not much of a problem. The biggest one which confuses people a bit at the moment is all your hooks in your component must be initialized always in the same order. They can't be in if statements, they can't be in loops. The reason is because the order in which they're called determines how they're registered. So if that would flip around, React would get completely confused. Hooks must also have the name use something. So use time, use context, use state. Seems kind of weird, but it's linting again there, which enforces that. So back in the Matrix, Neo got this question, like, you want to take the red pill, go down the rabbit hole, see how deep it is, or you want to take the blue pill, wake up tomorrow, and none of this has existed, you won't remember anything. You don't have to. Classes will just keep on working. They're not going to deprecate them, maybe sometime in the future, but not anytime soon. So all your existing code is going to keep on working. In fact, I would not recommend you start rewriting a lot of code using hooks. Classes are fine. Just gradually start introducing hooks in new code, maybe. We still have to work out best practices anyway, so don't go overboard with it. You don't like hooks? Stick with classes. That's fine. It's also, at the moment, like I mentioned earlier, a proposal. So if you go to this URL, reactjs.org/hooks, you'll see all the documentation on hooks, and there is a link there to request for comments page on GitHub, where lots and lots of people leave feedback. So highly recommended. And with that, I'd like to thank you. It was great being here presenting to you. I hope this is useful for you, and I hope to see you sometime in the future. Thank you.